Hi, my name's Matt Southcombe, and I'm the worship pastor for St. Michael's Church in Southfields, where I've been working since September of last year. In many churches across this country, and probably across the world too, there are civil wars going on about worship. There's probably no area of ministry in the church that receives more complaints and criticism and causes more controversy than the ministry of worship. You can guarantee that if one group are happy, then another group aren't. But the struggle here is not between Anglicans and Pentecostals, the Baptists and the Salvation Army. It's not even between the organ and the guitar. Quite often the biggest tension lies between the old song and the new song, the traditional and the contemporary. But both are vital to our worship. Both have different qualities. Both have their place. And I'd like to explore this a little. We're often fascinated with old things, old buildings and paintings, historical artifacts. They speak of a different age and represent the world from a time unknown and unfamiliar to us. So what is the old song and what role does it play? Established songs offer to us something that is historic. The old songs root us to the rich heritage of our forefathers and connect us to our identity together as the multi-generational church of God. The old song provides continuity and offers today's generations the chance to join together in worshipping with one voice and one heart. Thirdly, there's something of the vocabulary and the orthodoxy that the old song provides. It has proven its ability to articulate precious truths and gives us a language to celebrate the creeds and the theology of the church. Also, the old song offers us a sense of stability, of safety and satisfaction. Familiarity is often, as we know as humans, comfortable and enjoyable. We all have our home comforts and our favourite meals. The old song plays an important and a crucial part of the worship life of the church. But yet, when all we have is the old, our tendency is to back off from seeking the new and the new things that God is doing and wants to do on this earth. Isaiah 43 verse 19 says, "I am about to do a new thing." When we settle for only the old song, we enjoy the benefits, but there is one lacking dimension. There is one thing that the new song supplies that is generally lacking in the old, and that is power. That's not to say that the new song is always powerful or the old one isn't. I'm sure we've all experienced occasions at gatherings where many new songs were being sung and there was no power. However, when the Spirit is breathing on our worship, it's the new song that has the ability to transform the spiritual landscape. Often though, the new song feels unpredictable or disruptive, but if we are willing to embrace and journey with those thoughts and feelings, the new song has the power to launch us forward in our walk and our journey with Him. But what is this new song? What do we mean when we talk of new songs? Many of us are involved in worship and are looking for new material all the time, new songs to learn and discover in order to bring a fresh response in our worship times. A new song, though, always has to be taken in the context of where it's sung. The song may be over 100 years old, but if we've never heard or sung it before, then it's new in our book. One kind of new song that is especially fitting is a song that is written by a member of our congregation. And perhaps someone in your church has that gift. And I encourage you to nurture and develop and encourage that gift. It is unique for your church and it is there for a purpose. But what about the song that has never been sung before? This for me is where worship gets really interesting, where the river of God begins to flow in a church service or meeting. And the worshippers, the musicians, the singers and the congregation are getting caught up in the glory and the presence of the Spirit of God. It's good to appreciate the lyrics that songwriters give to us. But when we're in the river, following the flow, we're in that amazing place where we're wanting to express a song of the moment straight from the heart. It may not rhyme, it may not have a smooth meter or melody, but it's fresh and it's passionate and it's alive. It's immediate, spontaneous. Most of the time it's a one-off, but it's powerful above all else. In Romans 7 verse 6, Paul speaks of the newness of the Spirit, which he contrasts with the oldness of the letter. His point is that the Spirit is ever new, and where the Spirit is, there is always something new stirring. And in Revelation, we read that they're singing both the new song and the old song together. Revelation 15, verse 3 tells us that they're singing the song of Moses in heaven. Now that's at least a few thousand years old. But there's an even older song recorded for us in Revelation. Revelation 4, verse 8. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God Almighty, who was and is to come. That song has no beginning and will have no end. But they don't just appreciate the old song in heaven. In Revelation 5 and verses 8 and 9, we read that the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb and sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God. So how do we hold both the old and the new, the traditional and the contemporary in balance? Well, the old song unites and gathers, and the new song breaks new ground. It propels things forward. The old song is useful so we can flow together, and the new song has the power to take us to deeper waters. Often though, worship leaders who are enthusiastic to see releasing of new songs sometimes make the mistake of devoting too much time to them, and the overall momentum of the service can suffer as a result. It's easy to love and get caught up in the new, but we need to learn to discern where the congregation has become disengaged and distant. Effective leaders and effective leadership have learned the dance between balancing the two, the old and the new together, bringing everyone forward. So let's learn to harness the power of the old song, to take people with us as we lead, and to release a new song, to rely on the leading of the Spirit and to encourage the whole body to experience not just a new song, but a new side of the character of God they hadn't known or experienced before. You.